Foreword and Introduction of Paulownia, Seven Stories from Contemporary Japanese Writers. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Abai in November 2013. Paulownia, Seven Stories from Contemporary Japanese Writers, translated by Sofu Taketomo. Foreword. It is a pleasure to write a foreword for my friend Mr. Taketomo's collection of Japanese tales. Our admiration of Japanese art is now so deep and so wide in Western countries that we are sometimes startled to realize how little we know of contemporary Japanese writing, which means how little we know of the inner life of Japan today. While statesmen and diplomats agonize, contriving elaborate machinery for the restoration and the maintenance of international goodwill, it is in the power of any of us, by reading such books as this, to become better acquainted in a pleasant hour with our neighbor's mind, and upon acquaintance goodwill grows. The service is perhaps beyond estimate which Japanese literature may render to us in the United States by thus preparing the seeds of friendship and of justice between nations. Whether Mr. Taketomo has made faithful translations, I cannot say, since I know nothing of the language and very little of the literature from which these pieces are drawn. But it is evident that these translations live and bring before us a world of people. We observe that the persons in the stories are like ourselves, or like the characters who may very well, we believe, surround us. Perhaps Mr. Taketomo has chosen from authors under the influence of Western literature, but in any case, true pictures of life in the East would probably serve approximately to portray us at home. The episode subtly told in Hanako, the extraordinary truth in Takase Bune, the story of the man who killed his brother, are as pictures of our world, seen through our eyes. What strangeness there is, dwells in the language. The literary method of these sketches suggests the art of the great Russian or French storytellers. Yet to call these selections realistic is not to account for all of their quality. Perhaps the Japanese writers imitated Western realists, but there is something alien, something which we are likely to call Japanese, in their power to represent life as it is, or as it seems to be. This power springs from the imagination rather than from a theory of art. The truth of the scenes here recorded is naive as well as poignant. Is it because the Oriental mind is new to us and seems therefore more acute, more sensitive, simply because its approach is unfamiliar? Perhaps, but I think there is something here which will not wear threadbare on closer acquaintance, as imaginative power, such as all artists long for, to feel and see vividly the whole drama of our daily life. This power comes from a way of living rather than from a way of writing. If Japan can teach us this, we may well spare an hour to learn from her. John Erskine. Introduction. Here are seven stories by three contemporary authors of Japan. On transplanting them into the soil of the English language, I must make a brief account of each author. Mr. Mori Ōgai, a Surgeon General in the Japanese Army, is also renowned for his deep scholarship in literature and for his own writings, which are of enduring value. His translation of Andersen's Improvisatoren was regarded as the best specimen of this kind of literature and is still widely read among the young men of Japan. I do not know how often I have read this book. On leaving the shores of my home country, I did not forget to put it in my trunk among a few classics of Japan, for it was the book in which I was introduced first to Italy and to Dante. We owe to Mr. Mori two admirable translations from American authors, Rip Van Winkle by Washington Irving, and one of those stories of early California life by Bret Harte. These were collected in a book with other translated stories by Daudet, Tolstoy, Turgenev, Hacklender, Stern and Kirchner. Mr. Mori wrote many books of criticism and translation, among which his translations of Faust and Goetz and his Life of Goethe are monumental works. Besides these, he has written many original poems, dramas and stories. The stories included in this book are taken from some of his latest works. In my judgment, Takase Bune seems to reveal most of his qualities and merits. The subject was taken from the life of the 18th century, when Japan was under the iron rule of the so-called shogunate. The two figures, who are nothing but a humble criminal and a guard, are reflections of the clear minds of the age as well as of the spirit of Japan, which partakes of centuries of thought. The plot is extremely simple. The characters are only two, depicted with the writer's tranquil, dignified and tempered words, which somehow reminded Japanese readers of Flaubert or Mérimée. Mr. Mori may not regard the other two stories as very important among his works, but they were so fresh and sweet to us that when we saw them in a magazine we felt as if we were looking at the white roses in the morning dew. It is the color of white that is characteristic of his writings. His treatment of Rodin may be a sort of tour de force, but still it has a vivid description of the character. I read it with a friend in the palm room of a restaurant at the riverside of Kyoto, with a glass of kale and a plate of fruits. We were delightfully surprised when Rodin asked about the mountain and the sea. There is a glimpse of Hiroshige's print which is seen often in some corner of a European parlor, but so faint that the old blue color passes almost unnoticed in the general tone of the marble white. In The Pier you will find the same reflection of the Japanese mind under a brighter sky in the character of a noble lady. How different she is from all your ladies of society! I cannot say which is better or which is happier, but the innermost sentiment does not seem to me to be different anywhere in the world. It is wonderful to consider the two and to think of their difference in manners and customs. Compared with the hero of Takase Bune, you will find that the external development of Japan, its wealth and social ranks, has nothing to do with the moral sentiment of our people. That is what we are somehow proud of and somehow ashamed of at the same time. If the general tone of Mr. Mori's works is white, the color of Mr. Nagai Kafū is peacock blue, or it may be well to say crimson. He is essentially a colorist. His colors have become more somber with his maturity till we have such works as The Bill Collecting. Here you will find a maid-servant who is compelled to work for the class most humiliating at the present time in Japan. We see the sensitive feeling of her heart, like the dueless pedesa, as it is called in Japan, and the overflowing indignation of the writer at the sham respectability of society. It is written by the masterly hand of a social satirist. Is this a La Damo Camellia, who is speaking under the disguise of a Japanese maid? No, Mr. Nagai is a Japanese poet, all in all, but his attitude toward the world, his taste, and his early mode of writing often suggested the decadent literati at the end of the old feudal government. Spending most of his younger days in China, America, and in France, this character became submerged so deeply under the surface of his writings that when his two volumes of stories written in America and France were published, he appeared as a new star in the literary world of Japan. He watched the leaves falling in the Central Park. He sighed to see how soon the leaves of America are on the ground, for he is a poet in the real sense. How emotional he is before a thing of beauty may be noticed in his sketches of Ukiyo-e, which I have included in this book. Mr. Shimazaki Tōson was first known as a lyric poet, and he was a successful poet too, for once there was none in Japan who was a peer with Mr. Shimazaki in the poetry of Dolce Stil Nuovo. At last the new days have come. he wrote triumphantly in the preface of the collection of his poems, and it will be a long time before we forget the strain of Nessun Maggior Dolore, which came, unconsciously, from the mouth of our young poet. With the Russo-Japanese War, the literature of Japan changed its whole aspect. It was called the Destruction of Vision, or the Age of Disillusion, and was the proclamation of naturalism. Since then, Mr. Shimazaki has taken himself out of the poetical field and retired to the mountain in his native province. We did not hear from him again till 2 or 3 years afterward, when he returned to Tokyo with a novel. Then he wrote several stories and novels, but alas, there was no more the poet of the Alpine breeze. His novel was compared with Madame Bovary, and his stories with Turgenev and Maupassant. But I think the critic who mentioned the pictures of Millet was most clear-sighted, one who knew his tendency in reality. The two short stories which I include in this book will show this. Intimacy was the paramount thing he brought out in his writings. Intimacy with nature and intimacy with life, which he tried to clothe with plain homespun realism. But he did it so skillfully that even amid the current of crude naturalism he stood preeminently as an artist. These writers, I am glad to say, are typical stylists of contemporary Japanese literature. Their tendencies are different, and tendencies of thought are always moving. On reading these stories, some critics will say that there is classicism in Mr. Mori, romanticism in Mr. Nagai, and naturalism in Mr. Shimazaki. If you will put neo before each ism, it will be more accurate. But what is the use? It is always difficult to decide what tendency an author has shown in his works, and it is often misleading to trace back the lineage of the minds of the East, no matter what was their culture and what was their constitution of mind, in the much-questioned traditions of the West. Walter Pater says that, quote, "In that house beautiful, which the creative minds of all generations, the artists and those who have treated life in the spirit of art, are always building together, for the refreshment of the human spirit, these operations cease." End quote. If you find a beauty in the lacquerware of Korin, or in the black and white of Sesshu, here you will also find some beauties which are entirely proper to us Japanese, and which are also tending to the deeper current of humanity. The title of the book, Paulownia, has a particular meaning to the Japanese mind. The word Paulownia is the name of a tree from which a lute of peculiar charm is made, one which produces various sounds. In this book are 7 productions by 3 different authors, all showing the melody of the Japanese mind. Torao Taketomo. End of Foreword and Introduction.
First story of Paulownia, 7 stories from contemporary Japanese writers, translated by Torao Taketomo. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Awai in September 2014. Takase Bune by Mori Ōgai. Takase Bune is a small junk that goes up and down the river Takase in Kyoto. During the Tokugawa period, when a criminal of Kyoto was sentenced to banishment to a distant island, the relatives of the criminal were called out to the prison house where they were allowed to bid him farewell. Then the criminal was taken to Takase Bune and was sent to Osaka. The man who took charge of him was a doshin, or a private, who was under the command of Machibugyo, the city magistrate of Kyoto, and it was the custom that this private permitted the chief among the relatives to go on the junk with the criminal. This was not openly acknowledged by the government, but was called looking over with generous eye, or the tacit toleration. Though at that time the criminals who were sentenced to a distant island were considered as persons of great offence, It was not that the majority of them were condemned with such ferocious rascal as the incendiaries or the murderers. Most of the criminals who went on board Takase Bune were people who did unintentional crimes by so-called misapprehension. As an example, there was a kind of criminal who committed suicide with his lover, but remained alive after he killed his partner. Taking such criminals on board, Takase Bune was rowed out when the sunset bells began to ring from the temples. It ran toward the east, facing the dark houses of Kyoto on either shore, and went down across the river Kamo. In this junk, the criminal and his relatives talked over their lives through the night, always the repetition of the same story, of which the repentance is of no avail. Listening beside them, the private, who took the duty of the guard, could know in detail the sad circumstances of the relatives and the family from which the criminal has come out. This was the situation of which the judges who listened to the official statements or the court deliveries on the white sands of the city government or read the written statements on the desk of the office could never dream. There were different characters among the persons who took the duty of the private. Some of them felt only annoyance and were so cold-hearted that they almost wanted to cover their ears, while some others were deeply moved with the sorrows of other people which touched their hearts, though they would not show their sympathy, as they were doing their official duty. Sometimes, when a criminal and his relatives with the most unhappy circumstances happened to be guarded by the private of especially tender and sympathetic heart, this private could not help weeping with them. Therefore, the guarding of Takase Bune was considered and disliked as the most unpleasant duty among the privates of the city government. When was it? Perhaps it may have been during the age of Kwanzai, 1789 through 1800, when Marquis Shirakawa Rakubo had ruling power at Edo. In a spring evening, when, as they say, the cherry blossoms of the temple Chio-in fall in harmony with the sunset bells, a strange criminal who had no similarity to any that had been seen till that time was taken to Takase Bune. His name was Kisuke, a man of about 30 years of age who had no settled abode. As he had no relative to be called to the prison house, he went on the junk all alone. Haneda Shobe, a private who was ordered to guard him and went on board with him, had heard only that this Kisuke was guilty of the crime of fratricide. Now, while he was escorting him from the prison house to the pier, he looked at the appearance of this thin, pale-colored Kisuke, and found him quite frank and obedient, respecting Shobe as an officer of the government, trying not to offend him in any point. Moreover, these were not the flatteries to authority under the pretension of the mildness which were often perceived among the criminals. Shobe thought it strange, and so, after they went on board, he paid minute attention to the actions of Kisuke, more than his duty required. That day the wind ceased to blow in the evening, and a thin cloud that covered over the whole face of the sky blurred the outline of the moon. It was an evening when the slow approaching warmth of summer was felt as if rising like a haze, both from the earth on the shore and the riverbed. After they left the down quarter of the city of Kyoto and passed across the river Kamo, the surroundings became so quiet that they only heard the lappings of the water cleaved by the prow. Though the criminal was allowed to sleep in the night boat, Kisuke did not seem even to lie down, but kept silent, looking at the moon whose light was changing bright and dim according to the thickness of the cloud. His forehead was cloudless, and his eyes had a faint brightness. Though Shobe was not looking straight at him, he was constantly keeping his eyes on Kisuke, repeating, "This is strange, this is strange," in his mind, because the face of Kisuke looked so completely happy that he seemed even to begin to whistle or hum a song as if he was not afraid of annoying the officer. Shobe thought in himself, He could not remember how often he had managed this Takase Bune, but all the criminals whom he had taken on the junk had the same pitiful appearance that he could hardly bear to see the sight. Now, what is the matter with this man? He looks as if he is on the picnic boat. It is said that he killed his brother, and no matter how hateful a man the brother was, and what the circumstances of his killing him, he must be feeling badly if he has a human heart. This pale-colored, thin fellow? Is he such a peerless villain who is entirely lacking in that human sentiment? He does not seem so. Is he, haply, insane? No, no, his words and deportment do not show any such self-contradiction. The more he thought of the attitude of Kisuke, it became more difficult for Shobei to understand him. Becoming impatient, Shobei addressed him at last. Kisuke, what are you thinking? Yes, sir, replied Kisuke, who looked around him and seemed to be afraid that he had done something offensive to the officer. With quick apology, he looked up to learn the humor of Shobei. Shobei felt that he must make himself clear and apologize for the sudden question, which had no concern to his official duty. So he said thus, "Nay, I did not ask you with any special meaning. In fact, I wanted to ask you about your feeling in going to the island. I have guarded a great many people in this junk, and, though they were men of various lives, all were alike in lamenting their exile and wept through the night with the relative who looked after them and spent an evening in this junk. But looking at your appearance, I think you do not worry about going to the island. What are you thinking of?" Kisuke smiled and said, "I am so grateful for your kind words. Indeed, it must be a sad thing for other people to go to the island. I also sympathize with their feeling. But that is only because they spent easy lives in the world. No doubt that Kyoto is a splendid place. But even in that splendid place, there will never again be such torment as I have experienced there. The government was so merciful that it saved my life and ordered me to be sent to the island. However sorrowful the island may be, it cannot be the place where demons live. I never have had the place where I could stay as my home. But this time the government ordered me to make the island my home and allowed me to stay there without worry, and this is the first thing that I am so thankful for. Moreover, I have never fallen sick in spite of this feeble constitution, so I think I never will hurt my body by exerting myself with any hard work in the island. Then, as I was to be sent to the island, I was given 200 pennies, which I have here." Thus speaking, Kisuke placed his hand on his breast. It was the law at that time that a person who was sentenced to the banishment to the island was to be given 200 pieces of copper. Kisuke continued his words. "I have to confess a shameful thing, that I have never had the sum of 200 pennies thus in my breast. I sought to get work everywhere, and worked very hard as soon as I got it, and I had to deliver all the money I earned to another man's hand. I was pretty well off if I could live from hand to mouth, but mostly I paid my debts and borrowed again. But since I was put into the prison house, I was fed without doing any work. I cannot help but feel grateful to the government for this single fact. Besides, I was given this 200 pennies. If I could live on by things which will be given by the government, I can keep these 200 pennies without spending any of them. This is the first time that I ever possessed the money which need not be spent. Though I do not know what kind of work I can do there until I land on the island, I am looking forward with pleasure to use these 200 pennies as a capital of the work which I do in the island." After he said this, Kisuke became silent. Though Shobei said, "Is that it?" he also became silent for a while in deep meditation, for everything he heard was quite far from his expectation. Shobei was aged almost to the beginning of the old age and had already four children by his wife, and with his old mother, his family consisted of 7 members. Generally, he was living such a frugal life that he was called a miser, and he would not buy any clothes except the night clothings and those he wore at the office. Unfortunately, however, he took his wife from the family of a rich merchant. And though the wife had good intentions to live upon his stipend, she could not be economical enough to satisfy her husband, because she had the habits of a spoiled child in a wealthy family. Frequently, when the figures were wrong at the end of the month, his wife borrowed the money, secretly, from her home, for she knew that her husband hates the debt as the caterpillar. After all, this thing could not be hidden from a husband. Shobe, who was annoyed even to receive the things from her home on such days as the 5 festivals, or the clothes on the celebration of his children's coming of age, did not like to hear that the cracks of his livelihood were filled up from her home. This is the reason that the storms blew, now and then, in the home of Haneda, which otherwise had nothing to disturb its peace. Listening, now, to the story of Kisuke, Shobe compared the life of Kisuke to his own. Kisuke said that he had to deliver, from one hand to the other, the money that he earned by his work, which is really a sad and miserable condition. But, he reflected on his life, how much distance there was between Kisuke and himself. Isn't he also one who is living only by the stipend from the government and delivering it from one hand to the other? The difference between this and that is only the difference of the reeds on the abacus, and he had no savings to correspond to the 200 pennies which were so precious to Kisuke. Now, considering the difference of the reeds, it was reasonable that Kisuke was pleased with the coins of 200 pennies, regarding them as his savings. The feeling could be sympathized with from Shobei's side, but no matter how great the difference between the reeds may be, there was a more wonderful thing, which was the unselfishness of Kisuke, and his feeling of satisfaction. Kisuke suffered when he could not find work in the world, and when he had found it, he worked hard and was easily contented by only getting enough to keep him from hunger. Since he was taken to the prison house, he was surprised to see that the food, which was so hard to get until that time, was given without any labor, like the bestowment from heaven, and he felt a satisfaction which he never had experienced before. Here, Shobe found a greater difference, beside that of the reeds, between them. Though his livelihood, which he was making by the stipend, became sometimes short, generally the expenditure and the receipt were regular. It was life to the full extent of his power to comprehend it. Nevertheless, he never felt the satisfaction in it. Generally, he felt his life neither fortunate nor unfortunate. In the deeper part of his mind, however, an apprehension was always lurking which made him think about what he should do if, while thus living, he were fallen into a serious illness, or if he were suddenly dismissed from the office, and this apprehension appeared in the field of his consciousness whenever he learned that his wife had borrowed money from her home to fill up the shortness of the expense. Why had this difference come to his attention? Looking from the outside, he considered that it was only because Kisuke had no dependents, while he, Shobe, had some. But this is not true. Supposing himself a single man, Shobe did not think that he could feel like Kisuke. He thought that the reason must have a deeper cause. Vaguely, Shobe tried to think of a thing like the human life. When one had an illness, he thinks only, if this illness was not in him. When he had not his daily meal, he thinks, if he could only eat. When he had no savings for some unforeseen accident, he would think only of a small amount of money. Even then, if he had some, could he not have a little more? Thus, from one desire to another, man does not seem to stop, no matter how far he goes. He noticed that this Kisuke was the one who showed him that he must stop and look before him. Shobe looked at Kisuke with renewed wonder and felt as if a halo was shining over the head of Kisuke, who was looking up to the sky. Gazing at the face of Kisuke, Shobe addressed him again, saying, "Kisuke-san?" This time he said "san" or "mister," but the appellation was not changed with full consciousness. As soon as he heard his voice, Shobe noticed that this was not appropriate. But he could not take back the word which was already spoken. Kisuke, who replied, "Yes, sir," seemed to wonder that he was called with "san," and looked timidly at Shobe. Bearing his awkwardness, Shobe said, "I may be too inquisitive, but I have heard that you were sentenced to be exiled to the island at present because you have killed a man. Will you mind to tell me the story?" Kisuke said, "Willingly, sir," with the appearance as if to plead his guilt, and began to tell the story in a low voice. "I really have no word of apology for myself, as I did such a dreadful thing under a great misapprehension. Thinking over it later, I myself cannot understand why such a thing has happened. It was really done in a rapture. I lost my parents by pestilence when I was small, and was left alone with my younger brother. At first, the people in our neighborhood pitied us, and we grew up without being starved or frozen by doing some errands and such things for our neighbors. Even after we gradually aged, when we searched after work, we helped each other, trying not to be separated as long as possible. It was the autumn of the last year. I and my brother were employed at a weaving establishment at Nishijin, doing a work which is called karabuki, or the dryer. Meanwhile, my brother has fallen sick so that he could not work anymore. At that time, we were living in a place like a temporary barn at Kitayama, and were going to the weavers by crossing the bridge on the Kamiya River. When in the evening I came home with the food and the other things, my brother was waiting for me and always said that he must not let me work alone. One day I came home as usual, without any anxiety, and I found my brother lying on the bed with the face downward, and there was blood all around him. I was surprised, and throwing off the bamboo sheath, packages of food and other things, I approached him, saying, 'What is the matter? What is the matter?' Then my brother lifted up his death-pale face, which was dyed with blood from cheeks to chin, and saw me, but could not speak. Only a hissing sound came out from the wound each time he breathed. As I could not understand this at all, I tried to go nearer to him, saying, 'Say, what is the matter with you? Did you vomit the blood?' My brother raised up his body a bit, sustained by his right hand on the bed, and his left hand was clutching firmly a spot under the chin, from which a clump of the dark blood was flowing between the fingers. Speaking to me with his eyes not to come nearer, he opened his mouth. At last he was able to speak some words. 'Pardon, please,' he said. 'As I thought this an incurable disease, I decided to quicken my death to keep my brother a little of ease. I thought I could die if I could cut the windpipe, but only the breath came out. I tried to thrust deeper, deeper, and it slipped aside. It seems that the blade was not broken. I may be able to die if you take this out. It is so hard to speak. Help me, please. Take it out.' When my brother loosened the hand, the breath came out again from the wound. My voice was choked, so I could not speak, and silently I looked at the throat of my brother. It seemed to me that he had cut across the windpipe, but as he could not die by that, he had thrust the razor into the throat as if to gouge it. I saw about 2 inches of the razor's handle. Thus far I looked, but did not know what to do. I only gazed at the face of my brother. My brother was also gazing at me. 'Wait,' I said at last, 'I will run for a doctor.' Then my brother looked into my face with resentful eyes, and, clutching again the throat firmly with his left hand, he said, 'What can the doctor do? Ah, it is painful. Quick, take it out. I entreat you. Feeling at a loss, I was still looking at the face of my brother. It is strange that the eyes speak in such a time. My brother's eyes urged, "Do it quick, quick," gazing at me with such a resentful look. I felt that the inside of my head was turning around like a wheel, but the eyes of my brother did not cease that dreadful urging. Moreover, the resentfulness of his eyes grew sharper and sharper, until they became such fierce eyes as those that glare at the face of an enemy. Looking at this, I felt that I must do as he asked, and I said, "It cannot be helped. I will take it out." Instantly the expression of my brother's eyes changed, and he looked so serene and happy. I thought I must do it in one movement, so I bent my body forward just as I was kneeling. My brother let go his right hand with which he was sustaining himself, and helped by the hand which had clutched the throat. Firmly I caught the handle of the razor, and drew it out. Just at that moment I saw, opening the front door which I closed from the inside, an old woman entering the house. She was the old woman whom I employed to attend to my brother while I am away, to help him to drink medicine and to do other such things. As it was already dark in the house, I do not know how much she had seen there. Crying, "Alas," she ran out, leaving the door opened. When I drew out the razor, I took care to draw it quickly and straightly. But the unsteadiness of my hand was such that I cut some part which was not cut before. As the blade was facing to the outside, it may have been that a part on that side was cut. With razor clasped in my hand, vacantly I was looking at the old woman, coming in and running out. It was after she went away that I was awakened to myself and looked at my brother, who was already dead. A great deal of blood was flowing from the wound. Thus I remained gazing, with the razor beside me, at the face of my brother, dead with half-opened eyes, until the senators of the town came and took me to the office. When he had said this, Kisuke, who told his story looking up to Shobei's face, dropped his eyes. The story of Kisuke was quite logical. It may be almost well to say that it was too logical. This came about because he had reflected on the affair many times during about half a year, and because he had to rehearse it each time when he was required at the city office or before the court of the government. Listening to him, Shobei felt as if he was looking at the very scene. But when the story was half told, a doubt was raised in his mind. Was this really a fratricide? He could not answer the question even when he heard all of the story. The brother had asked him to draw out the razor because he thought that he would be able to die if it was drawn. So he drew it and let him die, which may be considered as a murder. But it seemed to Shobei that the brother had to die even if he was left in that condition. The reason that he wanted to die sooner was that he could not bear the anguish. Kisuke could not bear to see it, and, intending to save him from that anguish, he cut short the life of his brother. Is this a crime? Undoubtedly, the fact that he killed him is a crime. But the doubt came here, where Shobei thought that it was done to save anguish. He could not solve it by any means. After much reflection, there came into Shobei's mind a desire to put the burden upon someone who was superior to him. It was the desire to follow authority. Shobei too wished to make the judgment of the honorable magistrate like his own. But even when he desired this, there was something in his mind which he could not understand, but somehow he wanted to ask the honorable magistrate about it. In the gloomy night that declined hour after hour, Takase Bune, loaded with two silent men, glided along upon the surface of the dark water. End of the first story. second story of Paulownia, Seven Stories from Contemporary Japanese Writers, translated by Torao Taketomo. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Abai in September 2014. Hanako by Mori Ōgai. Auguste Rodin came into the studio. The spacious room was filled with sunshine. This Hotel Biron was a luxurious building, originally erected by a certain rich man, but later on it became a convent of the School of the Sacred Heart, and remained so until a short time ago. Perhaps in this very room the nuns of the Sacré-Cœur called together the girls of the Faubourg Saint-Germain and taught them their hymns. Just as the little birds cry out on seeing from their nest the mother approaching, so the little girls, standing in rows and opening their mouths, may have sung. Those cheerful voices no longer may be heard. But another sort of cheerfulness is reigning in this room. A different life is dominating. It is a voiceless life, but though voiceless, it is magnificent, pulsating, and cultured. There were several lumps of gypsum on each of several tables. The master is accustomed to begin several works at a time, and to work on them intermittently, according to his mood, until complete. As various plants bloom at the same time, so certain of his works grow, like things in nature, some rapidly, some slowly. This man has a tremendous perception of form. His works are growing before his hands touch them. This man has a tremendous power of concentration. The moment he begins a work, he is able to assume the attitude of continuing a work begun some hours before. With bright face, Rodin looked over the numerous half-completed works, that face with a broad forehead, a nose that seemed to have a joint in the middle, a white ample beard that crowded about the chin. There were knocks at the door. Entrez! A deep, powerful voice, unlike that of an old man, vibrated through the air of the room. The man who entered the door was a lean fellow of about 30 years of age, with dark brown hair and a Jewish cast of countenance. He announced that he was bringing Mademoiselle Hanako, as he had promised. Rodin did not change his appearance either when he saw the man entering or when he heard the words. Once, when a chieftain from Cambodia was staying in Paris, Rodin saw a dancer whom this chieftain had brought, and he felt a kind of attraction for the flexible movements of her long, slender limbs. The dessins taken in haste are still in his possession. Rodin, believing, as in that case, that every person has something of beauty, a beauty to one who discovers the point, had heard that a Japanese girl called Hanako had been on the stage at the Varieté for several days. Through a mediator, he asked the man who had charge of Hanako to bring her to his house. The man who had come was the manager, the impresario. "Let her come hither," Rodin said. It was not merely from lack of time that he neglected to show him to a chair. "I have brought an interpreter with us," the man said, as if to learn his humor. "Who is he? Is he a Frenchman?" "No, a Japanese who works at l'Institut Pasteur. He heard from Hanako that she was called to you and desired to come as interpreter." "All right, let him enter also." Instantly, two Japanese, a man and a woman, entered the room. Both of them looked peculiarly small. The manager, who followed and closed the door, was not a tall man, but the two Japanese reached only to his ears. Rodin's face wrinkled about the eyes, the wrinkles which seem to be carved at the inner corner when he looks at things intently. The wrinkles showed at this time. His gaze moved from the student to Hanako and stayed there for a while. The student saluted and grasped the right hand Rodin offered, the hand on which each sinew stood on the surface, the hand that had created La Danaïde, Le Baiser, and Le Penseur. and taking out a card on which Kubota, M.P. was written, he delivered it to Rodin. Rodin glanced at the card and said, "Are you working at l'Institut Pasteur?" "Yes, sir." "Have you been there for some time?" "Avez-vous bien travaillé?" Kubota was surprised. He had been told that Rodin says this as a habit. Now these simple words were spoken directly to him. "Oui, beaucoup, monsieur." At the moment he said this, Kubota felt as if he were swearing to be diligent for life. Kubota introduced Hanako. Rodin looked down as if to comprehend her with a glance of the eye, and he saw the small, trim body of Hanako, from the unbecomingly dressed hair of Takashimada to the tips of her feet in white tabi and in Chiyoda sandals, and he reached forth and took the tiny but robust hand. Kubota could not but feel in his mind a sort of humility. He wished that he had a finer person to introduce to Rodin as a Japanese woman. His feeling was not unreasonable, for Hanako was not a beauty. She had appeared in the European cities as a Japanese actress, but the Japanese themselves knew nothing of such an actress. Of course, Kubota also knew nothing about her. Moreover, the actress was not a beauty. It might be too severe to call her a servant. She did not seem to have worked especially hard, for her hands and feet were not hardened. But even at her bloom of 17, her appearance would hardly rank her as a chambermaid. In a word, she was not more presentable than a nursery maid. Unexpectedly, Rodin's face showed a glow of satisfaction. He was pleased with Hanako. Healthy, with no sign of indulgence in leisure, with firm, elastic flesh, well developed by proper exercise, characteristics that were vividly shown in the face, short from forehead to chin, in the bare wrists and gloveless hands, and in the thin skin which showed not a particle of fat. Hanako, who was already accustomed to European manners, took the hand of Rodin with an amiable smile on her face. Rodin offered chairs to both of them and said to the manager, "Please wait for us a while in the parlor." After the manager was gone, they sat down. Offering the uncovered box of cigars to Kubota, Rodin said to Hanako, "Are there any mountains or sea at Mademoiselle's home?" Hanako, as is common among the women in such a profession, had a regular stereotyped story of her life, which she told to persons whenever she was questioned. Just as in the case of the little girl in Zola's Lourdes, who relates the miracle of the recovery of her injured feet in the train, her story became, through frequent repetition, like the composition of the routine storyteller. Fortunately, the unexpected question of Rodin upset this ready-made plan. "The mountain is at a distance. The sea is close by." The answer pleased Rodin. "Did you ride on junks frequently?" "Yes, sir." "Did you row yourself?" "No, sir. I did not row as I was still small. My father rowed." A picture came into Rodin's imagination, and he became silent for a while. Rodin is a man who is often silent. Rodin said abruptly to Kubota, "I presume Mademoiselle is acquainted with my profession. Would she be willing to remove her clothing?" Kubota reflected a moment. Of course he did not wish to be instrumental in causing a woman of his own country to bear herself before another man, but he did not object to daring it for Rodin. There was no need on his part for reflection. His hesitation was due to the doubt as to what Hanako would say. "Anyway, I will speak to her."
"If you please."
Kubota addressed Hanako in this manner. "The master has something to consult you about. I think you understand that he is the peerless sculptor of the world and models the shape of the human body. This is the point about which he wishes to consult you. He wishes to know if you will oblige him by posing to him in the nude for a few moments. What do you say? As you see, he is an elderly man, not far from 70,
Moreover, he is such a fine gentleman. What do you think?" Thus saying, Kubota looked attentively into Hanako's face. He was wondering whether she would be overcome with shame, or affect airs, or blame him. "I will," she replied frankly and naively. "She consents," Kubota told Rodin. Rodin's face shone with pleasure, and rising up from the chair, he took out paper and chalk, and said to Kubota as he laid them on the table, "Will you stay here?" "The same thing is sometimes necessary in my profession," said Kubota, "but it might be unpleasant to Mademoiselle." "Then will you wait there in the library? I shall be through within 15 or 20 minutes. Light a cigar, if you like." He says he will be through within 15 or 20 minutes. Saying these words to Hanako, Kubota went out through the door shown him. The small chamber into which Kubota stepped had entrances on either side and only one window. Bookcases were on the wall opposite the window and on the other walls that constituted its wings. Kubota stood a while, reading the titles on the leather bindings of the books. This was a collection which had been assembled rather by chance than by intention. Rodin was by nature a book lover, and it is said that he was always carrying a book in his hand, even in his young days of misery, when he was roaming the streets of Brussels. Among the old dusty books, there must be some of varied memories, and brought here with purpose. As the ashes of his cigar were about to fall, Kubota walked toward the table and dropped the ashes in the receiver. And, wondering what were the books on the table, he took them up to see. On the furthest edge of the table, leaning against the window, was a book which Kubota took to be a Bible, but, on opening it, he found that it was the Édition de Poche of the Divina Commedia. The book aslant was one of the works of Baudelaire. Without any idea of reading, he opened the first page, on which there was a treatise entitled The Metaphysics of the Toy, and, wondering what was in it, he all at once began to read. The treatise opened with this memory, that when Baudelaire was a little boy, he was taken to a certain demoiselle who had a room full of toys, and told he might have his choice. After a child has played with a toy for a while, he is possessed to break it. He wonders what there is beyond the thing. If it be a moving toy, he wishes to search after the origin of the impulse. Hence, the child goes from physique to metaphysique, from science to metaphysics. As it was only 4 or 5 pages, Kubota, becoming interested, read through to the end. Then there was a knock. The door opened and Rodin's white-haired head peeped through. "Pardon me, you must be tired." "No, sir, I was reading Baudelaire." Saying thus, Kubota entered the studio. Hanako was already dressed. 2 esquisses were lying on the table. "What of Baudelaire were you reading?" "The Metaphysics of the Toy." "The same idea pertains to the human body, that the form is not interesting simply because it is a form. It is a mirror of the soul. The inner flame, showing transparently through the form alone, is interesting." When Kubota looked timidly at the esquisse, Rodin said, "They must be hard to understand, as they are so rough." He continued after a moment, "Mademoiselle has an exceedingly beautiful body. She has not a particle of fat. Each muscle arises on the surface like the muscle of a fox terrier. As the fibers are tight and thick, the size of the joints is made the same as the size of the limbs. They are so firm that she could stand on one leg while the other is stretched at the right angle, like a tree that has its roots thrust deep in the earth. This is different from the Mediterranean type with broad shoulders and loins, and does not resemble the North European type with broad loins but narrow shoulders. It is the beauty of strength." End of the second story. Third story of Paulownia, Seven Stories from Contemporary Japanese Writers, translated by Torao Taketomo. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Abai in September 2014. The Pier by Mori Ōgai. The pier is long, long. The rails of four railroads cut straight and obliquely the beams of the iron bridge on which the long and short crossbeams are like the bars of a xylophone on which children play. Through the cracks of the crossbeams, that almost catch the heels of shoes and wooden clogs, here and there the black waves are shown, reflected on the white flashes of sunshine. The sky has cleared into a deep blue. On the inside of the train, where she was sitting with her husband starting today, she did not think the wind was blowing. When leaving the jinrikisha, in which she rode from the station of Yokohama, and standing on this pier, she found that the wind of the 5th of March was still blowing as if to bite the skin, fluttering the skirts of the Azuma coat. It is the Azuma coat in silver grey, which she loosely wears on her body, that carries the child of her husband, who is starting today, this day which is not far from the month of confinement. She came with her hair in sokuhatsu. Her boa is of white ostrich. Holding the light green umbrella with tassels, she walks along, surrounded by four or five maidservants. The pier is long, long. The big ships are anchoring on the right and the left of the pier. Some are painted in black, some in white. The anchored ships are making a fence for the wind. Every time she leaves the place where there are ships, a gust of wind blows and flutters the skirts of her Azuma coat. 2 years ago, immediately after he was graduated from the University of Literature, the Count, her husband, had married her. It was during the previous year that she gave birth to her first child, a princess like a jewel. At the end of the year, the husband became a master of ceremonies at the court. And now he is starting to London, charged with his official duty. In his newly made grey overcoat, flinging the cane with crooked handle, her husband is walking rapidly along the pier. The Viscount, who is going with him, and whose height is taller by a head than his, also walks rapidly beside him, clad in a suit of similar colour. The French ship, on which her husband is about to go abroad, is anchoring at the extreme end of the right side of the pier. A stool, like that which is used to repair the wires of a trolley, is stationed on the pier, and from it, a gangplank is laid across to the bulwark. While walking slowly, she sees her husband and the Viscount, his companion, crossing the gangplank and entering the ship. The group of people looking after them are standing here and there on the pier. Almost all of them are those who came to bid adieu to her husband and the Viscount. Perhaps there are no other passengers on this ship about to sail who are so important and are looked at by so many people. Some of them are going to the foot of the stool on which the gangplank is laid, and stop there to wait for their companions. Some of them are standing at the place, a bit before the stool, where the blocks and ropes are laid down. Among these people there must be some who are intimately known to her husband, and some who know him but slightly. But, standing under this clear sky, they all seem dejected, or is it only her fancy? The pier is long, long. Following slowly after them, unconsciously she looks off to her right, where there were many round windows on the side of the ship. The faces and chests of women are seen from one of those round windows. Three of them are from 30 to 40 years of age, all with white aprons on their chests. They must be the waitresses of the ship. supposing them to be the waitresses who wait on the passengers of the ship on which her husband is on board, she feels envious of even those humble women. There is also a woman at the bulwark, looking down on the pier, who wears a big bonnet with white cloth and carries a small leather bag in her hand. Two big eyes, as if painted with shadows, are shining on her wrinkled face above the large nose, like a hook. She looks like a Jewess. She also must be a traveler who is going on this ship. She is also envious of her. The pier is long, long. At last she arrives at the foot of the gangplank. Cautiously she carries her body, which has the second infant of her husband under the Azuma coat, and descends on the deck of the big, black-painted ship. She hands the umbrella to a maidservant. Led by the people who have come to say farewell and were already on board, she goes back along the bulwark toward the prow. There are rooms for passengers at the end of the way, the numbers of which increase from 27 to 29. The Viscount is standing at the entrance and addresses her. "This is the room, madam." Peeping into the room, she finds two beds, under which the familiar packages and trunks are deposited. Her husband is standing before one of the beds. "Look it through, madam. It is like this." This is the room. She must look through it carefully. During the long, long voyage of her husband, this is the room where her dreams must come and go. A man who looks like the captain comes and, addressing her husband in French, guides him to the saloon of the ship. She follows her husband and the Viscount and enters the room. This is a spacious and beautiful saloon. Several tables are arranged, each bearing a flower basket. Gradually the people who came to say farewell gather into the room. By the order of this man, who looks like the captain, a waiter brings forth many cups in the shape of morning glories, and, pouring champagne into them, he distributes them among the people. Another waiter brings cakes, like those which are brought with ice cream, piled on a plate in the form of the whale crib, and distributes them among the people. The people who received the cups go one after another and stand before her husband and the Viscount, wishing them a happy voyage, and drink from the cups. Sitting on a small chair beside the table, she is waiting for the time when the congratulations are at the end. During his busy moments, now and then, her husband lifts his eyes to her. However, there is no more to be said to her before many people. Also, there is no more to be said to him before many people. The bell rings. Having bidden farewell to her husband and to the Viscount, the people are going out, one after another. She also follows them, saluting her husband and the Viscount. Again crossing the dangerous gangplank, she descends to the pier. She received the light green umbrella from the hand of her maidservant and raises it. Her husband and the Viscount are standing on the bulwark, looking in her direction. She is looking up at them from under her umbrella. She feels that her eyes, as she looks up, are growing gradually larger and larger. Again the bell rings. A few French sailors begin to untie the rope from the gangplank. A Japanese laborer in Hanten is standing on the stool, like that which is used in repairing the trolley, preparing to draw down the gangplank. Hanging on the rope of the wheel, pulled by the man in Hanten, the gangplank at last leaves the bulwark. The noon gun of the city of Yokohama resounds. With this as a signal, the ship, from the hold of which for some time a noise has been issuing, silently begins to move. The elderly Europeans, who seem to be a married couple, are standing at the bulwark. They are talking about something of a jolly nature with a white-haired old man who is standing on the pier, with one of his feet placed on an apparatus to roll the ropes, which looks like a big bobbin. They do not seem to regret the parting.
It looks as if the ship is moving. It looks as if the pier is moving. There seems to be the distance of a parallax between the place where her husband and the Viscount are standing and the place where she is standing. She feels her eyes growing larger and larger. Some of the people who are looking after them are running to the end of the pier. She cannot do such an immodest thing. Suddenly, something white waves at the bulwark. It was a handkerchief waved by the hand of a woman who wears a big bonnet decorated with a white cloth. A tall man stands at the end of the pier in red waistcoat and tan shoes. A white handkerchief waves also from the hand of this man. This also must be a parting in human life. These two persons set the fashion, and the handkerchiefs are waved here and there. White things are waving also from the people who are looking after the group surrounding the Count. She also grasps the batiste handkerchief which she has brought in her sleeve, but she cannot do such an immodest thing. When the ship seemed to have left the pier, it turned its prow a bit to the right. The place where her husband and the Viscount were standing has disappeared at last. Still, she can see a boy about 15 or 16, standing at the stern, in a blue, cold-looking garment like a blouse. What mother is waiting for him in France? Or has he no parents? What is he looking at, standing by the rail at the stern? Slowly she turned her feet and walked among the maidservants surrounding her. The pier is long, long. At the place where the black-painted ship was anchored until a short time ago, the water is glittering like the scales of fish as the small ripples are reflecting the pale sunshine. End of the third story. Fourth story of Paulownia, seven stories from contemporary Japanese writers, translated by Torao Taketomo. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Abai in October 2014. The Bill Collecting by Nagai Kafū. 1. Instantly after she got up from the bed where she was sleeping with Omatsu, her companion, Oyo put on her narrow-sleeved hanten as usual, and, wrapping her head with a towel in the manner of the sister's cap, she began to sweep the parlor. Oyo is the maidservant in Kinugawa, an assignation house. As they had guests in the inner room of Yojohan, who had been lodging there since the evening before, Oyo wiped up every place with the dust cloth except that room, including the railings and stairways of the first floor. Coming down to the fireplace near the counter, she found the mistress, with toothbrush in her mouth, already uncovering the charcoal fire of the previous evening. In contrast to the dark, humid interior where the odor of wine seemed to drift from somewhere, the winter sunshine glittering on the opposite side of the street and through the frosted glass screen of the front lattice gate looked quite warm and cheerful. As soon as the mistress saw Oyo, who was bidding her good morning, she said all at once, "Now, Oyo, I wish you would go directly after breakfast, as the place is far." Being thus ordered, Oyo took up her chopsticks for breakfast, eating before Omatsu and Otetsu, the cook. After having finished her toilet and changed her dress, and listening again to the instructions and messages from the mistress, she started. It was almost 7 o'clock when she set out in the new wooden clogs that were given her by the regular geisha girls as a present at the end of the last year, and she heard the voice of the cook supplier at the kitchen, the man who came to get the plates and bowls. Oyo went out by the familiar shortcut through the lane between the houses of the geisha girls. Coming out into the open street of Ginza, which was filled with sunshine, she looked around her as though surprised at the new appearance of things.
Her bosom pulsated to the sounds of trolleys passing by, and she not only felt that she had forgotten all the messages charged by the mistress, but even the route which she thought she had understood well when she left home. She became confused, so that the way seemed further than she had supposed. It had been 5 years since Oyo entered service, in the autumn, at the age of 14, at Kinugawa, the assignation house. She had been at Hakone and at Enoshima, she knew Haneda and the shrine of Narita, but it was only as an attendant of the guests and geisha girls in the great carousels of many people that she went to these places. Once, though she was a woman, she had walked alone through the night with 200 or 300 yen in cash in her sash. But it was not further than a few blocks, where she went to an accustomed bank on behalf of the mistress. It was only once or twice in a year that she rode a really long distance by trolley to visit her home at Minami Senju for holiday. To a woman of downtown who knows nothing about the suburbs of Tokyo, except Fukagawa, Shinagawa, and Asakusa, even to hear the name of Okubo in the uptown district where Oyo was going today to collect the bill, caused her to imagine a place where foxes and badgers live. As she also felt fearful that she might not be able to return home that day if she did not catch the trolley as soon as possible, she hurried to the square of Owaricho, not even stopping at the beautiful show window of Matsuya and Makamiya and Tenshodo. "Good morning, Maid Oyo." Suddenly, being thus addressed from the crowd which was waiting for the trolley, Oyo turned back and saw an employed girl of Tamaomiya, who had her hair dressed in hizashigami and wore the half-coat of koki silk. "Kimi-chan, going to temple?" As is a habit of woman, Oyo looked at the hair and clothing of this geisha girl, which was not particularly unusual. "No, I have a patient at home," Kimi-chan, the employed girl, said apologetically, as though answering the question of the employer. "Where are you going?" "To the place called Okubo. I was told to take the Shinjuku line. Is this the place to wait for it?" "Shinjuku... Then it is on the other side. You must take the car from the other side of the street." "Oh!" Oyo cried with such a loud voice that she surprised herself. And as if she could not hear the formal salutation of the employed girl, "Please keep me in mind again," she crossed the square to the other side almost in rapture. Though it was a winter morning, her forehead perspired. Having heaved a sigh of relief before the glass door of the Café Lyon, Oyo turned back with a wonder-stricken look to the other side of the street, where was the clock on the roof of the Hattori clock store, thinking that it was a marvelous thing that she was not killed in the midst of the square where so many trolleys are crossing. By that time, the employed girl of Tamaomiya, almost crushed among the crowds on the conductor's platform, went away toward the Mihara Bridge, and though many almost empty cars followed it, the only thing that passed the tracks where Oyo was waiting was a lumbering horse truck loaded with casks. The sidewalk near to the Café Lyon was so filled with persons waiting for transfers that they overflowed onto the street pavement. Unconsciously, Oyo looked at the blue sky of winter, calling to mind the clock on the roof of Hattori's building, which pointed to 11:30. She became so impatient that she felt she could not wait any longer. The complaints of the persons who were waiting for transfers, speaking in loud voices, the breaking of the wires or the stoppage of the electric current, disturbed her as though it were the announcement of a fire burning her house. Exhausted by waiting, Oyo, like the others, leaned against the glass door of the café and hung her head. Suddenly, becoming conscious of a commotion, Oyo also ran in order not to be too late for the car, but, being only a helpless woman, she could hardly approach the first car. Even the next one she missed, for a big man of dark complexion, crossing in from the side, had pushed her away when her foot was already on the step. Moreover, her side lock of Ichogaeshi was rubbed up by the sleeve of the double manteau with great force. "Now I won't mind what becomes of me. I will wait even half a day, or a day, as long as they want me to wait." Oyo, who had already become desperate, purposely followed behind the crowd to take the next approaching car. When they came to Hibiya Park, a seat was left, so Oyo could at last rest her tired back. Then the inside of the car was calmer, and the streets outside opened out and became more quiet, and in the warmth of the inside of the car, with the sun shining on the back of her neck and shoulders, she nodded involuntarily with the light jolting of the car. The fatigue of the body, which has to work every night until 1 o'clock at the earliest, pressed on her eyelids all at once. As Oyo is the favorite servant of the mistress, raised by her from childhood, she must help her not only in the parlor of the guests, but also as chambermaid. To be made a companion in the late drinking of the guest in her busy time is bearable, but the most disgusting thing is the troublesome task of washing clean, in a hot water cup, the whole set of artificial teeth of a guest nearly 60 years of age, every time after his meal. In a short time there were indications of the stopping of the car and passengers coming and going. Oyo awakened all at once, surprised, and looked out of the window. She saw a leafy tree, a high bank, and a low bridge on the waterless moat. The conductors, enough to frighten her, were assembled in front of the new house at the corner. Many empty cars were left, as if they were to be given away. With this sight of unfamiliar streets, Oyo felt unutterable helplessness. She became anxious about the thing in her sash, fearing that it had been stolen in her absent-minded moments. Also, she doubted whether this was the place to leave the car. Impatiently, she moved a bit from the end and said, "Please, what is this place?" The high-boned, flat-faced, slant-eyed conductor, who seemed to perceive the embarrassed figure of Oyo by a glance, did not move from the platform. Shrugging his shoulders as if cold, and turning his head to the other side, he pulled the bell so that Oyo, who had left her seat, was upset by the moving car and thrown with all the weight of her body on the lap of a man looking like a foreman of the laborers who was sitting near to the entrance. Feeling abashed, Oyo tried to get up quickly. She noticed that a big arm, as heavy as iron, was laid on her back, as if to embrace her body. She struggled with all her might. "Ehe, ehe!" With the vile, frightful laughter, there was a smell of wine. "How can I stand it when I am held fast by a girl?" "What good luck to have!" chanted one of the group that was sitting on the other side, and they burst into laughter. Oyo flushed like fire and wished even to jump out of the moving car. After that, she felt that all the eyes in the car were looking constantly at her. Even then she had not gained her composure after the fright of the moment when she felt herself closely embraced by a laborer. All at once Oyo became conscious that no one in the car was dressed like her, in meizen silk with folds laid somewhat loose, grey haori with an embroidered crest on it, and an apron of itoori neatly tied. All the other women were in hisashigami and in close folds, and most of the men passengers were soldiers. Her helplessness riding among these unknown people became more keen. Just at the time when she was about to ask the conductor, who came to inspect the transfer tickets regarding the station before Shinjuku, her embarrassment and helplessness became all but overwhelming. "This is the Aoyama line, miss. If you wish to go to Shinjuku, there is no other way but to transfer at Aoyama Ichome and again at Shiocho." Throwing the transfer ticket on the lap of Oyo, the conductor hurried to fix the dislocated pole. As she had understood that she could go all the way without transferring, Oyo, on hearing that she had to transfer not once but twice, felt as if she was thrown at last into the labyrinthic jungle of Yawata. 2. After going here and there, Oyo was able at last to realize that Tenmacho Nichome was the station before Shinjuku. How far would the troubles of the unknown route continue? Oyo regretted that she had come, and thought that she would never again go on an errand to an unknown place, no matter how she might be scolded. It is far better to stay at home with the sweeping, and to dry the bedclothes, or to wash the yukata to offer to the guests. In this broad street, more bustling than she could have expected, she could not tell whether she had to turn to the right or to the left. Nevertheless, as she could not stand in the middle of the street, she was thinking about paying her own money secretly to ride in a kuruma, when she saw a kurumaya from the stand, and asked him how much she would have to pay to ride to Okubo. "Give me 50 sen." "Don't fool me." Being much provoked, Oyo did not even turn to the kurumaya, who called out something to her from her back, and walked aimlessly to a side street. Seeing a little girl with tucks at her shoulders in front of a tobacco shop, she asked in an almost weeping tone, "Please, my girl, will you kindly let me know how to get to Yochomachi of Okubo?" "Yochomachi," said the girl cheerfully, "go straight this way, and going down a slope you will find a policeman's post. You had better ask at the policeman's post." Oyo felt revived for the first time. "Thank you ever so much." Putting an overwhelming sentiment of thanks into these simple words, Oyo walked away, looking curiously at the sights on both street of the somewhat narrow street. There was a European building for moving pictures on one side. From the lane near to the building, a few geisha girls came out, laughing about something in loud voices. Looking at them, Oyo wondered, why are there geisha girls in such a place? Suddenly she heard a tremendous noise. Before she could think what was the matter, she saw many soldiers on horseback riding from the open street to this narrow side street. There was the gate of a temple at one side of the beginning of the slope, and, taking advantage of an open place, Oyo was fortunate enough to get out of the way. She saw 6 or 7 men employed on the telegraph wires, squatting on the earth, eating their luncheon. A bamboo ladder was leaned against a wire pole on the other side of the street. "Hello, the beauty!" Their teasing started Oyo running away in embarrassment. "We are receiving an extraordinary benten." "Hey, my girl, may I offer you a glass?" Some of them were looking intently at the folds of her skirts. They could not contain themselves any longer when a sudden wind had brushed aside the skirts of her underclothes. All of them burst in at once. "Luck to see! It is worth 2 yen at Shinjuku! The red clothes are said to keep long!" And they continued to say things which were unbearable to hear. But is not the procession of the soldiers endless, stirring up the sand on all sides? And how much Oyo wished to escape! Oyo finally got away from the place and went down the slope, almost running, when she suddenly stumbled on a stone and hardly kept from falling. In front of it, she saw something that looked like a squirming heap of rags, which said, "Ladies and gentlemen passing by, please, a penny." 2 or 3 leper beggars, at whom one could not bear to look a second time, were making bows on the sand of the street. The town at the foot of the slope was visible, with the dirty roofs in confusion, at the bottom of the valley-like lowland. Oyo wondered, without any reason, whether the town over yonder was the outcasts' quarter. Going down the slope and turning to the left, as she was instructed by the girl of the tobacco shop, she easily found a policeman's post. As a policeman who looked good-natured was standing in the middle of the street, she asked him her route. "What number of Yochomachi is it?"
"It is number 62. The house is Mr. Inuyama's."
"Number 62. Then you have to go straight along this way and go up the slope before a big wine shop."
"I see. And let me see, is it the third side street after you go straight up the slope?"
"You turn there to the left, where you will find number 62.
"Much obliged to you."
Before she had gone less than half a block, she found a wine shop that looked like the one she was told about, and also a slope, so she thought the rest of the route was quite short. Feeling somewhat proud that she had come this far alone without the kuruma or without going much out of the way, she forgot a while even the fatigue of her legs, but when she began to go up the slope, she had to meet another unexpected trouble. Though the downtown district had had such continuous clear weather that it was annoyed by the dust, the uptown quarter of the city seemed to have had rain the night before, and the street, which was not broad, was so deep in mud that Oyo could not even find the sidewalk. By the time she discovered that the mud was melting frost, which had not had time to dry, not only the toes of her new wooden clogs, but also her white socks, newly washed, were all splashed with mud. On one side of the road was the bank covered with sepiaria, and on the other side was a cryptomeria hedge, where, taking advantage of the fact that there were no passers-by, Oyo took out her pocket papers and wiped, she knew not how often, the mud from the mat lining of her wooden clogs. As she glanced up, she thought the third side street to which she had been directed by the policeman might be the corner she sought. 3. The mud of the melting frost became harder and harder. A big, masterless dog was roaming about with a menacing look. The rasping sounds of a violin were heard. The dreary sigh of the wind came from the trees nearby. Far at the end of the side street, the ground seemed to slope again, and, though the winter sunshine was falling gently on the roofs of the new houses, and on the deep forest that covered the rears of all the houses, either side of the road was dark in shade, and all the houses were surrounded with fences of 4-inch boards. Each had a small gate containing a slide door, the faces of which were smeared with mud that had not been washed off, which seemed to have been placed there in mischief by the boys in the neighborhood. The number and name of the house, which Oyo found at last, after examining all the labels on the houses on both sides, was on the support of the small gate, where the mud was splashed thickest and dirtiest. Inuyama Takemasa. Oyo looked at it again before she entered the gate. The gentleman called Mr. Inuyama was the most captious, unsympathetic, and unreasonable among the numerous guests that came to Kinugawa. No matter how busy they were in attendance in the parlors, he would not be satisfied if he could not call up Oyo and all the other maids into his room. If the mistress did not come to salute him every time he came, he would be angry and say, "You insult me," or "You treat me coldly." It was said that he gave up his membership in the parliament as it did not suit his dignity. His profession at present was that of a politician. He was fond of geishas as young as babies, and if the girls did not obey his will, he was so furious that nobody could touch him, and Oyo not only despised him more than any of the other guests, but also was afraid, without any reason, of his forbidding appearance and loud voice. He always wore European clothes and used to come in a kuruma pulled by two drawers, saying that the lower class of people ride in a trolley. Once in a certain conversation, when the mistress had said to him that, "In these days not only the expenses of your pleasure and the tips for geisha become dearer, but even your expense for kuruma must be very considerable," he laughed. "Mistress, the money is earned to spend." But these prosperous days were no longer. When it was hardly December of that year, Mr. Inuyama suddenly stopped coming, and in spite of many letters he would not respond to the bill of 200 yen of that month and the 50 yen balance of the previous month. Kinugawa was obliged to talk it over with a geisha, who first brought Mr. Inuyama after their meeting at a certain Matsumotoro, but it was almost clear that she could not shake her sleeve when she had none, and so January passed in this way, and now it was February. The mistress sent Oyo to the mansion of Mr. Inuyama to reconnoiter. Oyo had known numerous cases of this kind, not only of men like Mr. Inuyama, but also of many other guests. She thought this nothing more than the bad ways of people. She thought only that they will be enjoying themselves at some other house if they do not come to hers. Then it will be good of them if they will be more considerate and pay the bill. The reason Oyo looked again at the label on the gate was the fact that the gate of his mansion was so dirty. But to enter the gate was better than the annoyance of walking around aimlessly any longer in the frost-melting road, so she looked around from the porch with its dirty and broken paper screen, wondering which was the servants' entrance. On the right hand, beyond the bamboo fence, was visible the roof of a one-storied house, looking cold under the garden trees. She got a glimpse of an old red blanket and a dirty cotton gown hung on a clothes pole, through the crevices of the bamboo fence. On the left hand, further on, were one-storied houses with lattice gates, and another that looked like a rented house. Beside the wheel well, where the plum blossoms showed their buds, a fishmonger was cutting a salted salmon. Two maidservants in careless hisashigami, who carried babies under quilted gowns and wore European aprons which had become grey, seemed to be at the height of their silly conversation with the fishmonger. As soon as they caught sight of Oyo, whose appearance was quite different, they sharpened their eyes and, seeming rather to fear her, looked her over attentively from top to toe. The road from the well to the servants' entrance was spread with straw bags of charcoal, and the muddy water of the melting frost ran into the feet of people walking on them. Being in much perplexity, Oyo could not move a step, and, bending her waist, said, "I beg your pardon." Both of the maidservants stood wonder-stricken with open mouths. "Is this Mr. Inuyama's house?" Suddenly one of the maidservants began to grow uneasy, and, perceiving her manner, Oyo said, "I came with a message from Kyobashi. Is the master at home?" "He is absent." Then the baby on her back began to cry. Oyo, as she was ordered by the mistress, remembered how to proceed when she was told the master was absent, namely, to call Madam to the servants' entrance and leave the word that she was the messenger from Mizuta, which was the name of her mistress. However, as Oyo was only 18 or 19, she felt somewhat timid and stood on the walk, forgetting even that the water of the melting frost was overflowing on her polished wooden clogs. The baby on the back of the maidservant cried more and more. "Chiyo! Chiyo!" Suddenly a voice of woman, close to her ears, aroused her. Being astonished, Oyo turned and saw at the broken paper screens of the servants' entrance, not farther than 6 inches, the big face of a woman, like a horse, with the eyes widely separated from each other. The careless hisashigami could not be beaten by the maidservants. She was a big, clumsy madam in a dirty and creased hifu. Just then the fishmonger came to offer 3 slices of the salted salmon to madam. Madam continued talking with the fishmonger, and Oyo, at last somewhat aroused and feeling at the same time a sense of deep disappointment, went out from the gate as if to escape, for she felt that her troubles in coming so far had been all in vain. She was exceedingly sorry for her mistress, as she had been entirely deceived by this humbug. When Oyo rode again in the trolley, she felt, at first, the fatigue of the vain effort, and at the same time the fact that she was unbearably hungry, but being unable to do anything about it, she arrived at Ginza. The sun was already declining. Calling to her mind the clock-stand of Hattori, which she saw when she was waiting for the car that morning, she looked up, and, lo, was it not already near to 4 o'clock? Oyo felt her heart sinking with melancholy, picturing in her mind the flash of her mistress's eye, who never would say to her, "How early you are!" when she returned from the faraway errand. The electric lights were already lit in the shops. End of the 4th story.
fifth story of Paulownia, seven stories from contemporary Japanese writers, translated by Torao Taketomo. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Abai in October 2014. Ukiyo-e by Nagai Kafū. The following sketches were written on seeing a collection of famous prints, which were exhibited at the Imperial Museum during the month of April in the 44th year of Meiji, 1911. The Woman of Utamaro. What a languid sweetness! What a dreamy pensiveness! The woman of Utamaro, almost swooning, tortured, benumbed by that fullness of pleasure which stirs all the sensibilities of a body called woman. Oh, the woman of Utamaro! Your body is only of soft, soft skin, of smooth, smooth flesh. Is your soul melted and your bone lost? When you are sitting, you twist your body and bend your neck. You are always leaning against a pillar, a railing, or a chamber window, sitting with upraised knee to attract attention to the roundness of the thigh bigger than the waist, and exposing with such indifference the fair whiteness of the calf. When you are standing, you are wonderfully tall. The long sleeves, the trailing skirts, though the dress you wear is, sometimes, a thin transparent gauze through which your arms, your bosom, and even the crimson crepe on your waist are seen, still you hardly seem able to support its weight, and I fear lest you fall. Though your hair is always dressed so faultlessly that there is not a single stray lock, you never try to adjust your loosened sash. Are not the folds of your undergarments open, and your dress almost slipping down from your shoulders? What are you looking at when you stretch your long neck as you lift up your face? Is it the landscape, the ferry boat on the Sumida River, or do you hear the bustling sounds of Ryogoku? Nay, nay, your small slender eyes must be following after the shadows of a dream that will never come to an end. No wonder that you cover your mouth with one of your sleeves whenever you have to speak, as if to say, I cannot speak so shameful a thing. No wonder that you hesitate, touching the long hairpin with your slender fingers. You seem to avoid the sunshine because it is too bright, and the blue color of the sky because it is too deep. Oh, the goddess of pleasure of the land of Shamisen, for whom even the blowing wind seems to soften when he observes your too delicate figure. Standing in the twilight of fear and shame and secrecy, the passive woman of Utamaro is lamenting the once tempting pleasure, the lingering dream. The Flower Viewing. The shade of a huge cherry tree blooming in the fullest flower. An afternoon of a beautiful spring day. A sudden gale of wind scatters the snow of the falling flowers without reserve or compunction. Alas, alas, it is as though we behold all the sorrows of the world before our eyes. Lifting her long sleeves of furisode, a little princess of about 14 or 15 years is turning her face aslant with her black hair that seems overweighted with ornaments. From right and left, the court ladies in maruwage, in their bloom of middle age, are covering the princess surprised by the wind with their sleeves of uchikake as a fence, shaking off the snow of the falling flowers. Today will be the last of the flower viewing for this year. Leaving the poem in lamentation of the spring, now let us go. A pretty attendant maid of about 17 or 18 years is trying to fasten on a branch of the cherry tree, a tanzaku, on which the poem of parting with spring is written by the princess. But the cherry branch is higher than the height of a plump maiden at 17 or 18. How can she reach it, though she stretch herself so? One of the attendant maids is on a cask of the sweet wine, on which is written Dai Kanai, or Great Luck.
The other is on the shoulder of a beautiful lad, who looks almost like a girl. At last the maid on the cask seems able to fasten the tanzaku on the branch. The wind of the falling flowers blows her skirts and sleeves like pennants. Squatting on the earth, one of the attending maids is holding the rather small cask lest it fall, but her heavy sleeves are being blown by the violent wind. The maid on the cask seems about to lose her balance. As her white legs are nearly peeping forth from the flowing linings of the fluttering skirts, she catches in one hand the branch, and in the other she holds her skirts, bending her slender body, and passing the toes of her feet firmly bent inward, she struggles to jump down quickly from her dangerous position. But see! The more fortunate one is the attendant maid on the shoulder of the beautiful lad. The attendant lad, who has been raised up to be a toy of women in the innermost chamber of the palace, where there is no one but women, is holding the attendant maid's waist firmly in his two hands, as high as his pliant shoulders. His face is downcast, aslant. How lovely is his mouth, tightened at the corners, showing the full force of his exertion in his features, more delicate than those of a woman. The rapture of heart and the pulsation of the bosom of the lifted maid is shown in the entanglement of her sleeves and skirts and the long knotted thongs tossed by the wind. In spite of her endeavor, with both hands holding the tanzaku, she does not seem able to fasten it on the branch. Oh, the calm inner garden in the spring, the blowing storm, the scattering cherry blossoms, the princess surprised by the wind, the attendant maid on the cask, the beautiful lad lifting up the maid. Ah, the symphonia of the delightful curves and the faded colors, all revealed by the print of Toyokuni the First, the dream of the pleasure of the days that are no more. Night. The bedchamber of women. Making the narrow room appear narrower in the short night near to the dawn, the bamboo, painted on the sixfold screen, outspread, conceals the ando light, which is as motionless as though it were tired. The hanging komon garments are flowing comfortably in the softness of a thing called silk, in the stifling warmth of the closed chamber. From the faded color of the red silk stealthily rises the odor of the skin and the remnant of the perfumes from powdered necks. Pleasantly they evaporate and drift through the darkness of the chamber where there is no man. Without even adjusting the loosened nightdress, the pliant half-bodies of two women slip out from the turned-back bedclothes of crimson crepe that look like pomegranates, bursting by ripened maturity, breathing flames. Come, get up! The cuckoo bird is cooing! What a gloomy sound! Will you lift up the lamp wick? I feel I am still dreaming. By the light of ando trimmed, the sound of the bird of night, which is not a dream, has ceased, and from the tokonoma, the place for decoration, the peony flowers in a bronze vase show their gorgeous petals, almost terrifying in their bloom. At the bedside is a picture of love in an uncovered book of romance, left as it was the evening before when she was reading it. Already come the sounds of a drum from the shrine of Seishoko nearby. No matter how the night of May hurries to the dawn, in comfortable sleep in bed where the mind loosens like a thong, in the bedchamber of women without men, the day breaks not yet. Lo, the ando! The oil is gone! End of the fifth story. Sixth story of Paulownia, seven stories from contemporary Japanese writers, translated by Torao Taketomo. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Abai in October 2014. A Domestic Animal by Shimazaki Tōson. Her first misfortune was at her birth.
She came into the world with short gray hair, overhanging ears, and fox-like eyes. Every animal which is called by favor domestic has a certain quality which attracts to itself the friendly feeling of man. But she did not have it. Nothing in her countenance seemed to be favored by man. She was entirely lacking in the usual qualifications of a domestic animal. Naturally, she was deserted. However, she was also a dog, an animal which cannot live by itself. She could not leave the hereditary habitat to be fed by people and then go back to the wild native place of her remote ancestors. She began to search after a suitable human house. This troublesome being strayed to the estate of Kinsan, a planter, when the building of the new wood-roofed rent house was just finished. The house was built along the village road of Okubo, located in such a manner as to enable one to go to the main street through the backyard. The floor was high, and the ground was dry. Moreover, there was a narrow, dark, unoccupied space at the foot of the fence between this house and the next, so that she could promptly hide herself in an emergency. She lost no time in occupying this underground refuge. The urgent necessity was to get the food. There were two more rent houses on this estate, which made four with the farm-like main house where Kinsan's family lived. These houses stood each against the other, and trees with graceful branches were between them. Her sharp nose taught her first the direction toward the kitchen. As she was hungry, there was no time for choice. Peeled skins of fruits, cold, evil-smelling soup, corrupt remnants of dishes, she ate everything she could get. If these were not enough to satisfy her, she smelt around even the dust heap and hunted as far as she could hunt. Some dirty socks were soaked in the wash tub beside the well. Gladly she drank the water from the tub. There was an old mokuse in the garden. She decided to make of their shade her resting place, stretching out her four legs on the ground, which was warmed by the sunshine through the leaves. She sighed or scratched the itchy spots. When it was evening, she entered her underground retreat and lay down on the charcoal bags which were under the floor above. A large wash tub she also tried. Sometimes she crept as far as the passage under the kitchen floor and slept on the charcoals in the warm charcoal box. Thus she began her life. Kinsan's family, at this time, kept a piebald dog of brown and white, whose name was Pochi. This lively Pochi was the only being who welcomed her. Pochi seemed to have a sociable nature. He approached her, politely scratching the ground. She made her return greeting by shaking her dirty tail. But Kinsan and the others who lived on his estate did not receive her as Pochi did. "Isn't it a great loss to be ugly, even among the animals?" remarked one. "I might keep her if she were a bit better," said another. All this was meaningless to her, and she was called Pup by these people who did not know. Each of the four houses had an aunt, which was the name given to the hostess of the family. Not only these aunts, but also their children, laughed at and hated her, and burst out railingly, calling her Pup! Pup! As for the uncles, they were more dreadful. The least relaxing of her vigilance caused them to chase her. Many things were thrown at her, stones, clumps of clay, the iron fire stick. Once a big club of the door guard was flung after her and made a wound on her hind leg. Gradually she understood the human mind. The significant twist of the mouth, a gesture as if to pick up something, the shrugging of shoulders and the bitten lips, all sentiments expressed against her, showed to her the deep enmity of the hunter. One day she was almost driven to bay in Kinsan's kitchen. Nobody knows how she was able to find the means of escape. People were crying, "Bring the rope!
The rope! The rope! She was desperate, and running through the garden, where were the dwarf trees, she went toward the hothouse. Turning around the barn, she escaped to the fields, where were the flowers to be sold on fete days.
"Gone at last," said one of the uncles.
"Isn't she a troublesome thing?" replied Kinsan, who laughed like a good-natured man. It was not only once or twice that she met such hard experiences. But she was not a dog to be crushed down by this kind of hardship. She would hunt around for food with calm composure, with the appearance of saying, "This is my own territory." Boldly she stepped into the new kitchen of the rent house or went up to the veranda with her dirty feet. She bit off the laces from the garden slippers and played with the washed things of the aunts, smearing them with mud and dust. She had no regard for the human children. This family had a girl named Ko-chan, who liked to come out to play in the yard, in big wooden clogs trailing on the ground. She chased this girl for fun. Sometimes Ko-chan would bring out a piece of tasty-looking cake and show it to her. "Look here! Look here, Pop!" Instantly she jumped at Ko-chan.
"Oh, Pop is wicked, Mama!"
This was always Ko-chan's cry for help. Then the aunt came hastily and called Ko-chan.
"Run away, Ko-chan! Quick! Why do you wear such big clogs?"
By this time, poor Ko-chan had nothing left. She had taken the cake from the crying Ko-chan, thus securing the sweets which are eaten by man. At such time, she usually licked the top of her nose with her red tongue. Nevertheless, there was no intention of good or evil in her actions. These words she heard from the uncles and aunts of the estate, but nothing about them was known to her. She had no understanding of the etiquette and civility created by man. She was only a dog. Whether her action was impolite or not, that was not a question. She was only a poor animal acting according to its nature. The cold, scanty, miserable winter passed while she suffered this "better go away" treatment. It was a wonder that she did not die from hunger. The begging priest, who used to come to Okubo every morning, said that even he did not get much. As to the humble woman who took a child with her, she was refused mostly by "no business" or "nothing doing." Even human beings were in a sad state. How, then, could they spare to this ignorant and useless animal, this embarrassing dog, a bowlful of their cold rice? She roamed on the snow in the far-off places and ate everything, even the skins of the orange. Meanwhile, the spring has come, and at the time when the frost began to melt, she seemed to be quite grown up. All the dogs, from Kinsan's Pochi to Kuro of the bathing house, Aka of the timber dealers, and the fearful big dog which was kept at the neighboring planters, gathered around her. Wherever she goes, she is followed by two or three dogs. So a comfortable place like that shade of Mokuse was overflowing with deep groans of dogs that sounded as if they wished to whisper or to flatter. An aunt who came to the well side with a hand pail in her hand saw this sight.
"My," she said, "Pup was a female dog. I never noticed that."
And the aunt of the new rent house, who happened to be there, also said,
"Neither did I."
And the two aunts laughed, greatly amused. She ought to be banished. Such was the argument which was raised in the estate of Kinsan. Among the members of the four families, however, the arguments raged between two parties, the uncles and the aunts. According to the point of view which was insisted upon by the aunts, it was now different. She was not in the condition she was formerly, and it would be too pitiful if she were to have a baby. As is expected of those with experience, the aunts were sympathetic, comparing her with themselves.
That may be so, but how awful it would be if she gave birth to children. This was the opinion held by the uncles. Indeed, there was nobody who was not anxious about her future. She did not know anything about this. Another day, a carriage stopped at the door of Kinsan. There was something like a lidless box on this carriage, which was covered with a dirty straw mat. Her quick nose smelt out what was in the carriage. Following after a policeman in uniform, came a dubious-looking man who entered the house. But she was not roaming in such a dangerous place. Pochi, Kuro, and the other dogs began to cry all at once. Now uncles, aunts, and all people of the village came out. "Dog hunter, Mama?" Ko-chan hid herself behind her mother. People ran around the garden. Kinsan's daughter, whose daily duty it was to water the flowers, ran out to the street with a dipper in her hand. A middle school boy who was painting a watercolor picture followed them, flinging away his tripod. "Thither she escaped, hither she ran." The confusion itself was very extraordinary. "Surely Pup is killed," Ko-chan said, trembling. At last she has escaped. A man with a big oak club in his hand shook his head to his companion. "No use, no use," the policeman said and laughed when he went out the gate. With disappointed looks, the two men drew away the empty carriage. Anyway, she had escaped with her life. And by, her bosom became larger. Her eyes began to be shaded with the restless color. Now she must guard not only herself, but also her children within her womb. Thus, the pleasant shade of Mokusei was no more the place for security. Even when she was comfortably lying on the moist earth, breathing out her agony for a while, she stood up as soon as she saw the shadow of a man. She could not be negligent even for a moment. To her eyes, there was nothing as merciless and cruel as the human being. But, in spite of her fear, she could not leave the human house. How at ease she would be if, like other animals, she could go to a distant forest and give birth amid the green trees and grasses. Thus it might seem to the looker-on, but it was not so with her. She was unable to change her inherited nature. It was just at the beginning of June that she finished her duty of motherhood. Four puppies appeared in the hothouse of Kinsan. Two of them were beautiful piebald puppies of brown and white like that of Pochi. One was entirely black, and the other was of ambiguous grey, very much like herself. Ah, it was in the morning of her motherhood that she first saw the smiles of human beings. It was also in that morning of her motherhood that she first had nourishing food since her birth. "Pup, come, come!" Opening the paper screen of the kitchen, the aunt at Kinsan's began to call her, as she has called her since that day. End of the sixth story. Seventh story of Paulownia, seven stories from contemporary Japanese writers, translated by Torao Taketomo. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Abai in October 2014. Tsugaru Strait by Shimazaki Tōson. As my wife is hard of hearing, she cannot understand what I say unless I speak close to her ear in rather a loud voice. Though the time to go on board the ship was approaching, she was still leaning on the window at the first floor of the inn, and would not even prepare to start. Vacantly she was contemplating the sight of the dark green sea, the sea mews flying in groups, and the Surugamaru, the regular liner which was about to start for Hakodate, ready to take us two on board. At such times she is always weeping, calling to her mind our departed son. This I noticed by the sight of her back. I stroked her on the shoulder and urged her to start. Come, get ready, get ready. The day was perfect for a voyage. It was the time when the regular steamship lines were interrupted by the rumor that the Russian ships from Vladivostok, which not long before had passed through Tsugaru Strait, were appearing now and then along the Pacific coast. During 5 or 6 days only was this line between Aomori and Hakodate in operation. As it was disappointing to my wife and myself to go home after having come so far, and as the Russian ships were said to be cruising on the open sea in the vicinity of Oshima and the Izu Islands, the very night before we had heard that the fleet of the enemy was sunk, the announcement of which some of the newspapers printed in an extra, we left the inn, not worrying about the ships, trusting somewhat to the truth of the statements in the extra. There were soldiers in the streets in sober khaki-colored summer uniform, watching us hurrying toward the pier. As my wife was walking in meditation, her slowness somewhat irritated me. She suddenly stopped, and this is what she said. "Ah, ah! If only Ryunosuke were living, I would bring him with us to a place like this and give him pleasure." She sighed. Ryunosuke was the name of our son. I did not know what to do, and, putting my mouth close to her ear, as if to scold her, I said, "You will try me if you keep constantly calling him to mind." Instantly, my wife flushed. "Oh, you are so cruel! I am living only because of the consolation of his memory. If you wish me not to speak of him, bid me die." My wife is tiresome, for she is just a baby, and I am only a nurse who is taking care of this infant of 40 years. "Tut, tut! How could you say such a thing in the street? Look, everybody is turning and laughing at us." I spoke thus, but the words were not heard by my wife. Ah! Nothing is so hard to foresee as human life. We never expected such a sad end to our son, nor did we ever dream of going together for this journey. It was caused by chance. The daily accidents, who can understand them? It was unforeseen that we should pass a night at this far eastern port of Oshu. It was unforeseen that we should go aboard this ship. Above all, it was unforeseen that we should be crossing Tsugaru Strait. It was not long before the boat started. She left the shore with the brave shouts of the boatmen in the Nanbu accent. The sailors of the ship were leaning on the bulwark, looking down at the approaching boats filled with passengers. Unfortunately, the first and the second classes were both full on that day. Although I was somewhat fearful, on account of traveling with my wife, to take the third class and be treated like cargo, I concluded from experience that nothing is better than the deck in such fine weather. Instantly upon our arrival on the steamer, we took our places at the prow. Meanwhile, upon the stroke of the bell announcing 10 o'clock, the noisy sounds of the weighing anchor were heard. The steam whistle was blown as if to bid farewell, and it resounded through the sky overhanging the harbor. The ship began to sail. The deck where we took our place was near to the mast, larger than one could reach around. When the cool wind blew from the southwest, sending the gay sunshine with the breezes, I felt at last somewhat revived. We spread the mat under the canvas shades and rested ourselves, leaning on some of the cargo. After a while I wanted to have a smoke, but, searching around my waist, I found there was no tobacco pouch. Then, gazing at my face, my wife said, "You see, surely you have left it again at the inn," and she smiled. This was quite a surprise to me. I thought I was very composed, but although I was constantly scolding my wife to brace her up, it was proved by this oversight that my own dejection was more than that of hers. "Now then," I thought, I myself must be somewhat queer. And I suddenly felt dispirited. The more I tried not to be overcome, the more my brain was oppressed with deep chagrin. No doubt I was becoming an idiot. The ship sailed out from the Gulf of Aomori, leaving behind the lighthouse of Hiradate, white in the distance. The sun was mounting higher in the sky. The dark blue waves of the Japan Current rolled in from the Sea of Japan, broke resoundingly against the side of the ship, and sparkled in the sunshine. In the lazy hours of the voyage, people came and went on the deck, pausing to admire the view. I also leaned on the bulwark and listened to the sound of the summer tides, filling my mind with the voice of the late July sea. Suddenly, my thoughts were possessed by my son. Bitter recollections gushed up in my heart. It may sound strange, coming from a parent's lips, but although he was only a boy when he died, he was clever enough to understand the joy and sorrow of life. My Ryunosuke was not a boy to be beaten by his fellow students in any of his studies. Observing the world, I noticed that the present age, lacking in faith, does not keep the young mind in quietude. Such was the short life of my son. Such an insatiable spirit as he is could not help investigating the meaning of life from exploring all its works, its glories, and its decadences. Leaving the curious multitudes who looked upon him as a great fool in his misconceptions, how did he feel when he retired from his life, silently, with unutterable sorrow in his mind? The desperation of thought, if the word could be applied also to the life of this youth, this was certainly the transient but brave span of Ryunosuke. Pity that he was not a sage. He discovered that his learning made him ignorant. Alas, my son quit his studies, and his studies quit him. At last he went to Nikko, and died by throwing himself into the fall of Kegon. I shall never forget that day when my son came home quite unexpectedly and bade us farewell without telling us his intention, nor that evening when I gave him my last reproof. The next morning, and the second morning, there has been grief in every morning since that time. My wife became crazed, weeping and crying. "It is your fault that you gave him such a reproof. Give me back my son alive, now, at once." It was inevitable. We were compelled to constrain her by force. We wrapped her in quilts, holding her. We scolded and cajoled her. But the strength of the crazed woman was almost more than ours. I myself did not eat nor sleep regularly for 7 days. Indeed, the condition of my wife at that time was such that it would not have been impossible for her to have followed our son, to have thrown herself into the waterfall of Nikko Mountain. When she became a bit calmer, I thought of a plan, which was this journey. I hoped that her distressed mind might be cured by seeing some of the famous places. As she had exquisite taste, in spite of her appearance, I thought I might be able to buy some ubi or sashes, if she cared for them. Inducing her to see the modern fashions, hoping to quiet her, we started out on this journey. Alas, my son! After he had passed through the bitterest sufferings, at the moment he came to think about death, even he could hardly have dreamt of his father becoming an idiot and his mother a lunatic, weeping during the day, thinking during the night, and roaming thus far to the northern sea. I, who am speaking this, am only a man who has spent a most ordinary but peaceful and quiet life in the country. How could I foresee that this peaceful life would change abruptly in its 43rd year? Seeking relief, we felt like wandering pilgrims. Inhaling the sea air of July, two fools were listening to the dreamy sounds of the waves, meditating upon the death of their only child. Strange imaginings came into my mind. If the dead body should float up from the basin of that waterfall and be borne away by the current, where would it go? Nowhere but into this ocean. Yes, yes, this restless place of wind and wave, this must be the grave of my son. Here Ryonosuke must be sleeping for ever and ever. Thus in fancy I was indulging my thoughts when the bell of 12 o'clock resounded through the ship. For lunch, a bento in a square luncheon box was distributed to each of the passengers. We could not eat ours on account of the boiled cuttlefish. But two young men, who came with their own luncheons, took their seat close to us and began to eat with gusto. One of them looked as though he were accustomed to labor. He reminded me of Anko-san, the young men who are said, after indulgence in wine and women, to draw the snow sledges at such a place as Goryokaku. The other boy looked 2 or 3 years younger than his friend, and seemed just about the age of my son. Apparently he was a student, as was shown by his naive appearance. And then, the youthfulness of the expression about his eyes when he looked at the sea through his spectacles was singularly like that of Ryunosuke. There is such a thing as the haunting resemblance of the stranger. However, I was quite surprised in my own mind, wondering whether it was possible for anyone else to see such a resemblance. How I gazed, rubbing my eyes, at the silhouette of the student. As for my wife, I looked at her and saw she entertained the same feeling. When we looked at each other, we understood our mutual thought without a word. Ah, it is unreasonable that I should meet my dead son on this ship, and it was a trick of my imagination that caused me to think that only if I should address him, he would speak to me saying, "Father, father," and, taking my hand, would complain of the mysteries and fears and agonies of the other world. Surely he is my son, my Ryunosuke. Such an absurd thought could only spring from the foolish heart of a parent. I do not know how often I repeated, "Ryunosuke, Ryunosuke," in my mind. I was tempted to cry out in a loud voice, and was astonished at my own absurdity. At last I addressed the young man. "Pardon me, where do you come from?"
"I?" the student smiled. "I came from Goshu."
"Goshu? Then you came from a long way off."
"Yes. I have an uncle in Sendai and came up to ask his assistance, but as I found him absent, being called out for war. Anyway, I'm going up to Hokkaido to try to find some work there. I have been told that there is profitable employment at Sapporo. If I cannot find work in Sapporo, I may go even to Ashigawa."
"Is that so?"
"Young men ought to be that way. You do not need to worry. You will find plenty of work, if only you have a mind to do it." Thus, comforting him, I recognized the simple, cheerful, and yet manly temperament of this student. Now and then the older companion glanced stealthily toward us with distrustful looks. I could not understand why this student had such a companion. I inquired of him and was told that they became comrades by chance. They seemed not especially friends, nor men from the same district. In other words, they were only fellow wanderers. My wife took out some apples from her package. These were bought the evening before at Aomori from a basket when we were surrounded by the women who sell fruit. Ryunosuke was fond of things with a delicate flavor, which my wife seemed to remember. As if to give them to her son, she selected the alluring yellow apples from the green ones and recommended them to the two young men. I told the younger one in detail of the loss of my son and the reason of starting on this journey with my wife, who cannot hear well, and added, "This also must be the work of fate, to meet you in this place. Please take one of them. Don't be ceremonious."
"Come, they are so kind. Let us accept them," said the companion as he pushed forth impudently.
"Please do so," I urged them, offering my knife. My wife was leaning on me like a child and gazing at the hands of the student paring the apple. Tears of memory seemed to flow ceaselessly down her cheeks. Forgetting everything, even our bodies, we longed for the recalled face of our son, whom we never expected to see in this world. The student and his companion bit the apples like hungry animals, so that even the crunching sounded delicious, and ate them heartily with vigor and appetite. "Sweet, isn't it?" Whispering to his companion, the student smelled the flavor of the apple, squinting his eyes. "Sweet." The companion also tasted his eagerly. By the time the 1 o'clock bell had rung, all of the passengers were tired of their journey. Some of them were lying down with their packages as pillows, some were sleeping on the deck with their mouths open like fishes. The reports of the Russo-Japanese War, which were much discussed about the mast, had entirely ceased. There was nobody on this ship who did not desire speedily to reach Hakodate. The only passengers who wished to continue the journey as long as possible in this way were ourselves. That was because we knew there were only 3 hours more to be with this young man and be reminded of Ryunosuke. After parting from him here, we were not sure that we should ever meet him again. Nay, not only should we never see again our son, but we should probably never again in our lives see the face that resembled his. "You are gazing at something, aren't you?" The student stepped out and patted the shoulder of his companion. The companion turned to him. "Look at that smoke." "Smoke?" "It is strange that smoke appears in this direction."
"Let me see."
"Where?"
"No, there is no smoke, nothing like it."
"Why can't you see it?"
Wondering at the conversation of these two men, I also left the side of the mast. Far off to the east of the strait, the dark, farther tide, on which groups of cuttlefish are accustomed to ride down, that curial tide dipping the horizon, shone white and yellow under the rays of the sun. Groups of clouds were floating in the sky. The excessive heat of a midsummer noon on the 30th of July seemed to burn the sea. The sky above the horizon was a dark grey, mingled with purple. The air was hazy, but nothing like smoke was to be seen. Before I realized it, the captain, who for some time had been reading The Law of General Average, went up to the bridge and was eagerly looking through the marine glass. Suddenly we felt uneasy. The ship had probably sailed at a fair speed since leaving Aomori. When she was sailing at full speed toward Cape Oma, which was on her starboard side, the cloud of smoke was seen exactly in that direction. After 20 minutes, a second smoke appeared, then a third. The Vladivostok fleet, which was said to have appeared along the coast of the Pacific Ocean, was slowly sailing from Cape Oma to Cape Tatsuhi. Approaching nearer, the ships became more distinct. When the three grey ships of the enemy, of portentous appearance, were seen approaching our defenseless vessel, sailors and passengers all stood up. The battle formation of the enemy was in single line. First came the Rossia, then the Gronboy, with the Riorik a little behind them. Joyful or sad memories or imaginings were all blotted out by this unexpected view. Nobody remained in the dark cabin. Forgetting the vertigo, the nausea, and the sufferings of fatigue, the 150 passengers came out at once on deck. All those who have been standing at the stern passed through the kitchen and pressed toward the prow. "Go down! Go down! Go down if you want to save your life!" But the cries and scoldings of the sailors could not control the confusion of the excited men, screaming women and children. The dreadful sound of the engine gave an added touch of gloom. As the enemy were known to be such vicious fighters that they sank even the sailing boat Seishomaru and robbed it of the money and cargo, all on board felt that there was no time for delay.
they bared their feet and tucked up their skirts in order to be as prepared as possible. "I will take charge of your wife." The words of the student were hardly heard. Having already lost her color, my wife stood shuddering close to the student. Death. We were face to face with that force. A group of sailors took off the duck rain covers from the lifeboats to prepare them for lowering at any moment. As it was the captain's hope to be within the limit of the protection of the fort, if only the ship could run 1 hour more at full speed, the ship dashed along with all possible speed, nay, even with a desperate force rather than speed. In this dangerous situation there appeared, suddenly, from the direction of Hakodate, our fleet running in the same direction as the Russian ships. The enemy also saw this fleet, and, seeming to hesitate, stopped their advance. The fact is that it was the time when they took the last resolution to pass the Tsugaru Strait again. Sending up volumes of black smoke, they began all at once to flee like a flock of birds. With the exclamation of "Banzai! Banzai!" all the people on the deck shook their hats toward our fleet. "Now we are safe." Turning back to my wife, I sighed with relief. "Safe," I repeated. My wife was still leaning on the shoulder of the student. As my wife and I, turning again to the thought of our son, settled down to spend the few remaining hours in conversation with the student, the Mount Gagyu appeared to our view. We caught sight of the red cliff jutting into the sea, the rugged precipice from whose surface the reflection of the sun shone white on the sky of the port of Hakodate. A seagull flew near to the bulwark, as if to congratulate us on our safe arrival. We arrived at the entrance of the port at the appointed hour, 4 o'clock. Ah, how great the joy of the people when they saw the streets of Hakodate from the deck! The grey roofs of planed board on the slope of the mountain, the new ridge poles soaring among the houses built in Nanbu style of stone and sand, the landscape covered with the green leaves of Matsubuna and Itaya, from the high tower of the temple shining in sunlight to the custom house, hospital, and the buildings of many schools. This prospect of the port of New Japan extended before our eyes, exciting our interest. The enormous group of people, gathered on the seashore, raised a wild shout of joy to welcome the safe arrival of the liner. The Surugamaru also made the air resound with whistles. Passing through the many sailing ships, steamboats, cargo boats, sampans, and lighters, the Surugamaru approached the pier, looking like a scared water bird who had barely escaped from peril and was hurrying to the shore, crying out to her friends. When the ship stopped and seemed to sigh with relief, the waves lapped around her with whisperings. Then the passengers jumped into the sampans and hastened to land on the pier. What a sight of madness! Persons landing, persons waiting to receive them, parents embracing their children, sisters their sisters, caressing and embracing. All the women wept for joy, which stirred the emotion of all onlookers. At last the time came to part with the student. Full of regret, I was standing vacantly in the crowd and forgot not only the clamoring hotel runners, but everything, even to the package I placed on the ground and the bag I was carrying, wishing only to continue speaking with this young man. How I was moved at this unexpected intimacy and this parting, thinking over the events of the day's voyage. Becoming conscious of the disappearance of his companion, we turned back and saw his arm firmly taken by a big policeman. "There, pickpocket," said those who gathered around us. "Look, what are you thinking about? Don't you know you have been robbed?" Being addressed by the policeman, I was aware for the first time that the package I had placed on the ground was gone. "What? Impudent!" exclaimed the student excitedly. "I am not such a man as to commit lawlessness." "Don't be excited. Where did you come from?"
I myself did not see you break the law, but you are the companion of the man who did it, aren't you?
As the policeman said this, I told him every fact I knew and defended the student from the imputation of being a suspicious character. The policeman nodded at each of my words, and, after he inquired of the student how he became a companion of such a scoundrel as the pickpocket, he made more inquiries and admonitions, and also advised me to appear against the thief in court.
Wait a bit. I want to keep your name and address.
The policeman took out his notebook and gazed at the face of the student.
What is your address?
Kusatsu Town, Awata District, Omi County.
Your name?
Nishihara Yasutaro.
Your age?
19.
After this catechism, the student bade farewell to my wife and me, and started again on his wanderings. I looked at the appearance of his back as he disappeared, and could not help being again reminded of my departed Ryunosuke. My wife, weeping and scarcely able to stand, looked after him, leaning on my shoulder. Gazing this way and that, we continued to look until the straw summer hat, the student-like figure in the white cloth of kasuri, disappeared amid the crowd, and at last faded away. End of the seventh story. End of Paulownia, Seven Stories from Contemporary Japanese Writers, translated by Torao Taketomo. Thanks for listening.